Penguin Random House Canada presents Dominion, The Railway and the Rise of Canada, written by Stephen Bown and read by Wayne Ward. Introduction, The Rise of the Canadian Empire. The Canadian Pacific Railway was Canada's first and greatest megaproject, a political and engineering feat of staggering dimension with over 4,000 kilometers of track, much of it driven through terrain unsuitable for railways. At the time, it was the longest and most difficult railway ever built. The CPR was a great triumph of imagination, vision, politics, and engineering, as well as a horrible environmental and social tragedy. The railway presaged a soaring immigrant population and titanic economic expansion and stymied the U.S. dominance of North America by enabling Canada's consolidation, but it also enabled the often cruel repression of the land's original inhabitants and the exploitation of thousands of laborers. To understand the CPR, one must keep that dichotomy in mind. By the late 19th century, the fur trade was in decline. After two centuries adorning the pinnacle of high society, the exalted beaver hat was toppled from its preeminence and replaced with something equally frivolous, the silk hat. Beavers from North America were out, and silkworms from China were in. This could have spelled economic disaster for the venerable Hudson's Bay Company, which had managed the economy of Rupert's Land in the Pacific Slope from its headquarters in London and Montreal for 200 years. But new opportunities presented themselves. Long antagonistic toward settlement to preserve the fur business, the company now saw its future in actively supporting and encouraging settlers, and, as the only commercial outlet with entrenched forts and trading outposts on all the major river systems that were then the only transportation routes, it was uniquely positioned to take advantage of the new and evolving situation. The company began running steam-powered paddle wheelers on parts of the Red and Saskatchewan rivers, but a major logistical problem hindered its activities. There was no practical route from the eastern Canadas to the new settlements developing along these rivers. Lake Superior was turbulent and difficult to navigate, and the land route north of it was nearly impassable to anything other than canoes and porters on portages. The rugged rocks of the lake's north shore made it nearly impossible to build a road there. The new region of commercial enterprise along the Red River was being serviced by paddle wheelers from the American territory of Minnesota, even after the entirety of the HBC's old haunts became part of the new country of Canada in 1870. It was clear this territory wouldn't long remain under Canada's control without a means for the eastern settlements along the St. Lawrence River to reach it without having to travel through the United States. To the west of the Rocky Mountains lay the British colony of British Columbia. An idea emerged in political and business circles in Ottawa and Montreal to connect the disparate British colonies in North America into a single entity that would stretch from the Atlantic to the Pacific, much as the United States had done a generation earlier. To many, the idea of connecting the British Pacific colonies to Canada and creating a new dominion while keeping the capital in Ottawa would be a brilliant and profitable undertaking. It would create an economic hinterland that could provide a ready-made source of consumers to bolster the output from the moribund factories of the East. The former Rupert's Land could be settled with immigrants who would provide a captive market for Eastern manufactured goods. But creating a true empire would require a connection between the political jurisdictions to enable travel and economic development, and a shared political culture with mutually beneficial objectives. The mid to late 19th century was the era of the railway. In Europe, where the technology was developed, and then in the U.S., where tens of thousands of kilometers of tracks were rapidly laid, including the first transcontinental railway completed in 1869. In our era, it is the digital economy that gets all the attention. But in the late 19th century, a railway was the vital infrastructure needed to create a broader web of economic activity and bind it to a nation to improve livelihoods and prosperity through the efficient transport and exchange of goods. In 1867, a sickly Swedish chemist named Alfred Nobel announced his incredible new invention that he called dynamite, a substance that had more than 10 times the blasting capacity of gunpowder and would pave the way for the industrial megaprojects that made the modern world. Harbors could be blasted and cleared for larger ships. Canals, such as the Erie, could be carved for barges to haul heavy bulk commodities. Land could be leveled for roads and railways, and tunnels could be dug through mountainsides. With dynamite, the Industrial Revolution fueled an economic and political revolution. For some people, railways served political objectives and were the physical manifestation of things more imaginary, such as the idea of a nation, while others just wanted to make money. Capitalism was the original crowdsourcing, a means to pool resources to undertake projects grander and more complex than any individual could afford, and to spread the risk of failure among a greater number. A transcontinental railway was the very definition of mission-oriented capitalism. Railways were the symbolic and psychological glue to bind an empire, as well as the practical means to rule it. With a transcontinental railway, Canada could aspire to become a less populated version of the United States. John A. Macdonald was the progenitor of this dream. He observed the prosperity generated by the increasing number of railways along the St. Lawrence and imagined a new dominion extending from the Atlantic to the Pacific. But the political, logistical, financial, and technical hurdles for such an ambitious project were daunting. Not the least was convincing the colony of British Columbia to join with Canada instead of remaining independent or becoming annexed to the United States. Most of British Columbia's commerce was with San Francisco, and the U.S. had purchased Alaska from Russia in 1867, thereby sandwiching B.C. between American territories with no access to any other political jurisdiction except by travel through the U.S. In 1871, B.C. agreed to join Eastern Canada with the condition that Canada would build a transcontinental railway at the earliest possible date. Surveys would begin immediately, and hopefully the project would be completed within a decade. Naturally, there were delays. The scouting and surveying of the route was itself a monumental undertaking subject to revision for political priorities. There were cost overruns, political opposition, two uprisings led by Louis Riel, and the initial refusal of the Niisetapi, Blackfoot, to allow the railway through their territory. In the 1870s, disease, primarily smallpox, was ravaging the West, and American whiskey traders were encroaching from the South, while a severe decline in the bison, commonly known as buffalo population, upon which the Métis and indigenous peoples depended, brought starvation. The construction of the Canadian Pacific Railway was the defining event of its era, around which most other events orbited. A catalyst for the powerful global forces were pushing the land towards something new. Its story is a sweeping tale, with technological, political, economic, geographical, and social components. It involves the dreams of politicians in Ottawa, Toronto, and Montreal, the financing genius and manipulative shenanigans of railway promoters to devise a business plan that would justify the expense, the feats of engineers to push a railway through the rock and bog around Lake Superior and through the rugged mountains of British Columbia, the adventures and hardships of explorers and surveyors, the occasional resistance of indigenous peoples, and the terrific and horrific work of the laborers who poured their lives into it. More than 12,000 laborers toiled on the railway at any given time, and many thousands of horses and oxen. Pay was poor, the work backbreaking, dirty, and dangerous, and there were many deaths among the predominantly European immigrant construction crews. Conditions were even worse for the Chinese workers, who were often assigned the most dangerous jobs, those involving dynamite blasting and tunneling. Yet the railway lay the foundation not just for Canada as it is today, a country that spans the continent from coast to coast, but also for the European-style settlement of the West and the creation of Canada's national park system. The last spike, fully connecting eastern Canada to Vancouver, wasn't driven until November 7, 1885, nearly two decades after the idea began percolating in the minds of ambitious politicians. The era was marked by greed, hubris, blatant empire building.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.